Good afternoon and welcome, colleagues. My name is Kate Almquist-Knopf, and I'm the director of the Africa Center for Strategic Studies. So it's my pleasure to welcome here this afternoon, and thank you all for coming out. We have a very distinguished panel before us, and a really timely and important topic on African models of peace operations. So our associate professor of conflict management and prevention, Dr. Jerina Biko, is going to be our moderator and guide through this discussion. So I'm going to turn it over to her, and she'll introduce the topic and our panelists. Thank you all.
Welcome to ACS at the Africa Center and to National Defense University. You know, 14 years ago, when the African Peace and Security Architecture, or APSA as it's known, came into being as the Organization of African Unity transformed into the African Union, I'm not sure we would really know the implications of going from a principle of non-interference to one of non-indifference, which is sort of what we see today. If we look around the continent, we've seen the African Union, the regional economic communities intervene with peacekeeping, peace enforcement, diplomacy, mediation, resolving electoral disputes, just a whole range of avenues in which they would resolve conflict, which I'm sure would not have been possible under the old OAU. And, you know, it really brings to mind, you know, what roles the AU plays, what roles do the regional economic communities play. There is a thought that the African institutions should be first responders, with the UN coming in and rehatting, which works well on paper, but is a lot messier in practice. And, you know, that also brings to mind, after, you know, a decade and a half of this, is there a model, an African model of peace operations? How do you bring practice and theory closer together? And I think our panel will help us tease out whether, in fact, we can look to an African model for peace operations. I'll introduce our panel to you. We'll first hear from Professor Linnea Gillo. She's a senior lecturer in peace and development research, and she's at the University of Gothenburg in Sweden, and her research interests are African politics, African security, regionalism, international legitimacy, peace and conflict management. She's currently researching a project on the African Union and civilian protection and the challenges that they pose for peace and development in Africa. After her, we'll hear from Jide Okeke, who is the head of policy development at the Peace Support Operations Division at the African Union Commission. He is involved in planning, coordination, management, drawdowns of peace operations in Somalia, Mali, the Central African Republic. He's also a non-stipendiary research fellow at the University of Portsmouth in the UK, with a focus on peace and security in Africa and the responsibility to protect. He's a PhD in international politics from the University of Leeds. After Jide, we will hear from Cedric de Koning, who is currently a senior advisor on peacekeeping and peacebuilding at Accord in South Africa. He's also a senior research fellow in peace operations and peacebuilding at the Norwegian Institute for International Affairs, and also a special advisor to the Peace Support Operations Division of the AU. He has a PhD in philosophy from the University of Stellenbosch, and focuses his research on the African Union, the European Union, and UN peacekeeping and peacebuilding policies and practices. And we will wrap up our presentations with Liz Morger-Howard, who will serve as our discussant. She's an associate professor at Georgetown University, the founder of the Masters of Arts program in conflict resolution at Georgetown. She has a PhD in political science from the University of California at Berkeley. And she writes on civil wars, peacekeeping, U.S. foreign policy, sub-Saharan Africa, the Balkans, and the Middle East. So I think we have a very rich panel here with brings lots of expertise to the table. And we'll start off first with Linnea.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Warm thank you to the African Center for inviting us and letting us come here to do this book launch, hosting us. A warm thank you to all of you who made it out here to listen to us. It's my pleasure to be here and talking to you today. Thank you. I wanted to give you a little bit of a background for this book project, how the book project came about, and then I want to just share with you the main messages coming out of this book before Cedric and Gide will share some of the more specific recommendations and findings coming out of the book. And so this really came out of a seminar that we put together, the Nordic Africa Institute in Uppsala in Sweden, together with NUPI in Oslo in Norway and the Training for Peace Network. We invited practitioners because we thought we need to give them the space to think about the strategic options going forward for African peace operations, because normally in the day-to-day business of policymaking and practitioners, day-to-day surroundings, they don't quite have the space to think about these longer-term issues, we thought. So, and then we also invited some of the participants to write chapters and contribute to the book project. We've had a wonderful time learning together with the chapter authors in the book. So what we wanted to do with the book was to set the stage for the coming necessary conversation about reforms of African Union peace operations, because we now have a decade of African Union peace operations where we can really look at the development that has taken place, the enormous capacity that has been demonstrated, and not only the regional developments that this has led to at the African regional level, but also the impacts that this has had on global policymaking in the area of peace operations. So we think that the book provides insight into the human and practical dimensions of peace operations in Africa, and it offers a snapshot of the dynamism of the now dominant modes and scales in this area. It stresses the need to learn from the emerging African model, and principally to set as a point of reference the complex hybrid nature of response challenges. Such a shift will force us to reconsider some of the ways that we conceptualize security governance. So really, one of the bigger messages coming out of the book is that what is going on at the sub-regional and regional level, which of course is influenced by responding to local political dynamics, is what is lifting some of these changes up to the global level, which is driving global policymaking at the moment. The book then concludes that in many ways, the proactive approach to peace operations and conflict resolution that we see in African peace operations today, and the ongoing reform process that is taking place in Addis Ababa, has in part been driving and now occupies an important shared space with other actors in the current global peace operation reform discussions. So I've seen the question put differently. It is, how do these developments fit into ongoing reform processes at the global level? But we would like to reverse the order of that question by saying, this is indeed in the driver's seat of global policy reform. African Union experiences and developments with peace operations over the last decade now acts, as we see it, as a significant frame of reference. And they make up a set of reforms that are global. They're global in at least two senses. They're global, firstly, because the conflicts that require interventions in Africa are transnational and intensely internationalized in character. These are wars and conflicts of concern to the United Nations Security Council and to the world community, both because they fall within the UN Security Council's remit and also because unless stability is provided and state authorities restored in some of these areas, instability and insecurity will spread across regions and also beyond the continent. Second, because African-led peace operations are also, by and of themselves, intensely internationalized. They operate in theaters where they are not the sole actor to respond to a specific war. They are operating in a theater together with many other multilateral institutions and with bilateral players and donors and so on. So the EU, NATO, the UN, countries, donors, and so on, are all sharing the space with the African Union in these places, which means that this hybrid nature of responding together to conflicts will drive policy innovation in conflict management and in peace building at large. So if, for example, we study the high-level implementation panel report on peace operations, if we study that panel's report, we see that it has helped reframe the narrative on cooperative peace operations. So we expect to see in upcoming consultations and developments in the relationship between the United Nations and the African Union, we expect to see a different kind of language going forward, which is not speaking about African regional actors as proxies or subcontractors, but rather as strategic partners. And that is a language shift, a shift in narrative that we show throughout the book, how this changes the relations and changes the ways of working together. We might, for example, expect that in the way the Secretary General will implement the HIPPO report, and in the conversations we'll be having at the UN about global peace and security for the coming years, we hope that this momentum towards shifting the language will be maintained, and that strategic partnerships is really what we're looking at from now on. And the argument made in the book is that such a shift in narrative has been earned. So this is in a way a symbolic recognition of capacity on behalf of African regional actors that has been demonstrated over the last decade. So we see that the HIPPO report and the Secretary General's report on implementation of HIPPO call instead for networked, tailored, flexible approaches to peace operations. In a sense, it'll be interesting going forward to see how this may lead to a reinterpretation of the Chapter 8 of the UN Charter, because to date, the logic of hierarchical relations has remained strongly present in the relationship between the UN and the African Union. But now this may herald a new discussion where we speak about strategic partners not as equal partners, they are operating in asymmetrical power relationship, but perhaps at least as partners in the sense that we see that partners will operate in the same theater of conflict, and they need to have complementary skills and expertise to bring to the table in responding to conflicts. And so hopefully this will, what we hope to contribute to is a direction where different actors calling each other more strategic partners will try to set the strategic objective together for how they are responding to a conflict. And they will therefore look at how their different complementary roles should contribute to hopefully a broadly shared strategic objective, so that the complementary skills and expertise are linked up to a strategic political objective. And again, an underlying, perhaps not the most prominent, but an underlying message of the book is that it wouldn't benefit anybody. It wouldn't benefit the African Union, the regional, sub-regional organizations in Africa, and it wouldn't benefit the partners to see a development where the African peace and security architecture becomes more and more imbalanced and perhaps militarized. So we touch upon that at a couple of times in the book, that do some of these policy developments mean that APSA, the African peace and security architecture, is becoming more militarized? And we hope not, because we see the need for the civilian expertise and the continued importance of preventive diplomacy to be thought of as important as the new emphasis on capacities for counterterrorism measures and mechanisms. Yeah. Okay. I'll be stopping there. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon to all the participants gathered here. Just to reiterate the point that my colleague made, we are really grateful for this opportunity to share some of the findings of our book and to situate the findings within the context of contemporary currents in relation to peace and security, and more specifically in relation to peace support operations. I would want to reflect on one particular issue in the book, which is tied to the institutional mechanism for the deployment of peace support operations. And in the case of the African Union, that would be the African Standby Force and its rapid deployment capability, as well as much more recently, the African capacity for the immediate response to crisis. And in sharing my reflection with you, I would want to focus on four main issues or four main aspects. The first would be to share what I would consider to be the context of peace support operations in Africa. The second would be to look at some of the issues that we are confronted with, especially in relation to the operationalization of the African Standby Force and its rapid deployment capability. And based on the book, to highlight what I consider to be some of the key messages that we are trying to advance. And finally, share what I consider to be the future of African peace support operations. In terms of the context that we face, just to reiterate the point that Linnea made, we are no longer aspiring to become, as the African Union, a strategic partner. I think there's a clear international recognition that the African Union is a strategic partner as far as peace support operations are concerned broadly, but in relation to the broader peace spectrum. And here I talk about both conflict prevention, mediation, of course, peacekeeping as well as peacekeeping. And this was clearly recognized in the Secretary General's report on the HIPPO of 2nd September 2015. So that debate is no longer one that we should continue to talk about. We have come of age based on empirical evidence that we are capable and have the regional legitimacy to deploy peace support operations. And tied to that closely is the evidence on the ground. In the last 10 years, the African Union has mandated almost 100,000 uniformed and civilian personnel. I think that in itself demonstrates that we are no longer supposed to be seen as just a recipient of support, but we are using the support that is being provided in ways that promote stability, at least as far as the continent is concerned. In terms of operational budget, what you would see is that an average cost operationally of peace support operations in Africa today is in financial terms about $50 million over a 6 month period. And this excludes the in-kind contribution that we get from our partners. And this is just very much tied to traditional peace support operations like we had in Central African Republic, but also in Mali in 2013. I am excluding AMISOM in this equation because if you have to quantify the financial contribution of AMISOM, you would be moving towards $1 billion over a year period. This is quite staggering, but if you have to compare that with traditional UN peacekeeping operations, it is actually, you realize that AUP support operations are significantly underfunded, because if you combine MONUSCO, UNMISS in South Sudan, and Darfur, you're looking at over $3 billion. So in terms of the comparison, I'm not looking at it in terms of the requirements. What we see on the ground today is our mission conducting high-intensity operations, but yet facing a situation of very limited resources. And in terms of impact, I think that is another issue which I want to talk about in contextualizing the African role or African Union's role in peace support operations. Our impact has been questioned by a number of our partners, but I tend to see that the impact that we have made on the ground is generally positive, and I would explain why. In Mali and in Central African Republic, the improvement of the security situation in those countries paved the way for the deployment of UN peacekeeping operations. I think that is quite a significant point to make. In the case of AMISOM in Somalia, I think it would have been incomprehensible for Paul Williams and myself to lead any civilian assessment in South Central Somalia. But I'm happy to note that I, as a civilian without a military training, I did lead an assessment to Barawi, which used to be the de facto capital of Al-Shabaab in 2015. And I think that represents for me progress in terms of the impact that we have made on the ground. I would turn to some of the issues, especially in relation to the African Standby Force and the ASRIC, the African Capacity for Immediate Response to Crisis. Despite all of this progress that we have made, we have not really made any structured linkage between active peace support operations and the African Standby Force. That is one issue. The second is that there have been claims that our deployments have not been rapid enough, which has reinforced the role of external actors in deploying in the case of Mali, for instance. And as a result, the heads of state of the African Union decided in 2013 to establish the ASRIC, the African Capacity for the Immediate Response to Crisis, as a transitional measure pending the full operationalization of the African Standby Force. As at December 2015, we conducted the Amani Africa tour. I think some of you in the room were actually part of this very historic event. And based on the exercise, the conduct of a field training exercise, there was a clear determination that the African Standby Force had attained operational readiness. Maybe not full operational capability at this time, but in light of what was tested, it was concluded that we are able to use the African Standby Force to deploy an RDC, that's a rapid deployment capability, but also a multidimensional peace support operations. That's the first point. The ASRIC as well has attained operational readiness based on the conduct of a command post exercise in 2014, but also participation in the conduct of the Amani Africa field training exercise in November 2015. However, the point and key messages that comes out of my reflection in my chapter of the book is that it doesn't matter what you call the mechanism, whether you call it the African Standby Force or the ASRIC. There are certain common challenges that we must face and address as the African Union in collaboration with our core partners. The first has to do with the mandating process. This is a political requirement for the deployment of the African Standby Force. Without streamlining or harmonizing the mandating process, it will be difficult for us to deploy any entity, whether it is called the ASRIC or the African Standby Force. Currently, you have to face multiple channels of mandating processes, right from the national level, where you generate the forces or capabilities, to the regional level, because the regional economic communities are actually the implementing partners of the African Union or the African Standby Force. Of course, you get to the AU, which would be the Peace and Security Council, and up to the UN Security Council. So all these multiple channels of mandating the deployment of the peace support operations must be mainstreamed if ever we want to attain or achieve rapid deployment. The second point has to do with first generation. On first generation, we do recognize that the capabilities, the African Union in itself inherently does not have any of those capabilities that we want to deploy. We have to rely heavily on the member states. And of course, the member states would also have to rely on the RECs, on the regional economic communities. There's that interface. But what we find is that all of this are consistently shaped by the political context. It is not just readily available. So today, if you have to deploy forces, hypothetically, to Burundi, there are certain powers or there are certain states within the East African regional mechanism that may not be eligible for deployment because of the contested political relationship with the Burundian authorities. So you would have to take into consideration the political context in which first generation occurs when it comes to the deployment of forces. And finally, financing would always remain a very important or a central point in terms of deployment. One of the promises of the ASRIC was that African states with the capacity could self-sustain themselves. But if you read the operational concept of the ASRIC, they are only expected to self-sustain themselves without reimbursement for 30 days, right? For a 90-day operation, you would require, of course, both the African Union to cover what we have referred to as common cost. But again, we would have to reimburse this volunteering state 60 days in terms of the operations. So funding would always be a central issue when it comes to the deployment of a peace support operations. To conclude, how do I see the future of peace support operations? I think there are 3 points I would want to make. The first is that the role of politics cannot be suspended in all considerations regarding the deployment of peace support operations. And we have seen this happen time and again in some of the conflict context or crisis situations that we face, including in Burundi, as I mentioned earlier. Second, funding would always remain a central issue or a determinant of when, how, and you know, to what would be the exit strategy, so to speak, of our deployment. I think this is a very big issue for discussion, and just recently the African Union chairperson, the Commission chairperson appointed Dr. Kaberuka as the AU High Representative for the Peace Fund. I think there is a need for the African Union to mobilize resources from within, but also it is very important for us to be able to harness support from other partners. And that is what would lead me to my final point. Partnership, especially with the United Nations, would always be very critical. In light of the practices that we have seen, or recent practices of transitioning from AU peace support operations to UN peacekeeping operations or peacekeeping missions, it will be vital for us to leverage on the capacities, especially in relation to mission support, which the UN has to offer. On that note, I would want to thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, everyone. And let me add my voice to thank the African Center for hosting us here today. So as Linnea and Jidi has explained, when we embarked on this project, we really looked at the trajectory of the African experience over the last decade or so. And that's why our subtitle of our book is From Janjaweed to Boko Haram. Because our first operation, as you know, was in Sudan, in Darfur, in the African mission in Sudan. And since then, the African Union has deployed a number of operations in Burundi, in Somalia, in Mali, in the Central African Republic. We've also had operations against the Lord's Resistance Army and currently, as you know, the operations against Boko Haram in the Lake Chad Basin. And so looking back at this experience and then trying to ask ourselves what does that tell us about where we are going in the future was really what informed our project. And maybe what I would add to what was said already is to say that one of the things we find in the book, or we try to argue in the book, is that we think if we look at this trajectory that we can talk about an emerging African model of peace operations. Right? So how is African peace operations different from other forms of peace operations? And this question is informed to a large degree by the fact that When we developed the African Standby Force concept back in 2002, 2003, before we had all these experiences, we largely only really had the United Nations as a kind of a model to base the African Standby Force and to base African peace operations doctrine around. But if we now look back at this experience, we found that African Union operations have become quite different in nature from UN peacekeeping operations. And it's important to understand this difference because, especially when it comes to the close link in terms of transitions between African Union operations and UN peace operations, and when it comes to the support that UN operations provide to African Union operations, it's important to understand the differences. And so one of the first things we would argue is that African Union operations are not bound by the same principles or concepts that UN peacekeeping operations are bound. So they do not operate on the concept of consent or impartiality or minimum use of force in the same way that UN operations are operated. And they are not bound by the charter distinctions between Chapter 6 or Chapter 7. Obviously, they are authorized by the UN Security Council, but they are authorized under Chapter 8, regional arrangements, as you're aware, and they are authorized in most cases to use force under Chapter 7. But they are not, in that sense, struggling with the distinctions that UN peacekeeping have to draw between being a defensive or an offensive type of operation. We would categorize almost all the AU operations as in the stabilization context of operations. Another important factor is that the African Union is, of course, deploying these operations on the African continent. So it's the African Union using this mechanism as a tool to manage and resolve conflicts on the African continent. So it's an act of solidarity. It's an act of dealing with our own, as opposed to someone deploying an operation into another theater. And that creates a different context, of course, for these operations as well. It also means that in many cases, when we talk about solidarity, you'll find that it's the African Union deploying a support operation to a country that is, for instance, facing an insurgency. And you have African Union forces operating alongside national forces against an insurgent force or against an aggressor. And this is, of course, where the distinction with impartiality in some of the UN peacekeeping operations come into account. Because the African Union is very often, many of the missions that we spoke about, a first responder, stabilization type of role, we also find that these operations are relatively short in duration before they then hand over to a United Nations operation. So a kind of a pattern has emerged where this has happened in a number of operations, partly also informed by the financial realities that Jide has referred to and that we can come back to later. Somalia, of course, being the exception where the African Union has remained as the primary actor for a long period of time. We also talk about African Union operations as essentially partnership operations. As my colleagues have mentioned, the United Nations High-Level Panel on Peace Operations also recognize that we are now in a new era of network peace operations or partnership peace operations, if you like, which means that it's inconceivable that we will have any operation, African Union operation or United Nations operation in Africa, where you will not have the United Nations present as well in some or other form, the European Union present in some or other form, a regional organization. So if the operation is in the Horn of Africa, you will have IGAD or the appropriate regional mechanism also present. And the roles may differ. At some point, the African Union may be the body executing the peace operation, and the other bodies will perform different roles, political, peace-building type of roles. In other cases, it may be that the United Nations, so for instance, currently the United Nations is responsible for the peace operation in Mali and Central African Republic, but the African Union have special political missions, regional missions in that area, and both in Misahel, in the Sahel, and Misak in the Central African region. So we will always deal with these multiple organizations in the same theater, and therefore the issue of strategic coherence among these different actors become very important. How they relate to each other, how we ensure that there's an overall strategic vision for what we are pursuing, of course, very much together with the national actors as well. Another characteristic that we would like to highlight is the variety of these operations. So although we're talking about an emerging model, the model is still very much emerging. The model is still changing, evolving over time. It's not as if we can really talk about a fixed model, but we can start to identify these characteristics that I've mentioned. And the other aspect is that there's quite a variety of operations. So the missions in Mali and the Central African Republic has been more similar to what you would expect of a United Nations operation, in the sense that there was a greater role of an organization, both ECOWAS and ECAS in the beginning, and then later the African Union, in deploying the operation and managing the operation. Whereas in a mission like the African mission in Somalia, is much more bottom-up, troop-contributing countries-driven, similar perhaps to, for instance, ISAF in Afghanistan. And then we have, you know, a range of other missions. We have the operations against the Lord's Resistance Army, or the operations against Boko Haram, which are essentially national operations operating on their own territory, but coordinating with each other because it's a regional dimension, and sometimes undertaking cross-border operations, joint operations, and therefore the coordination, the kind of headquarters that you have in that context is very different from the kind of headquarters you would have in the mission in Mali, or the headquarters you would have in AMISOM. And then we have at the moment also, as you know, a number of military observers and human rights observers in Burundi. They're supposed to scale up to about 200. So there again, we have the kind of observer mission, which is very different from the other type of operation. So still quite a variety. And what this tells us is that we need a great degree of nimbleness, a flexibility in our model. Colleagues like GD and the others in the African Union need to be able to plan this wide range of operations and need to be able to put together, whether it comes to force generation or funding or whatever it may be, they need to be able to manage several different models of potential operations depending on what the need is. So based on these characteristics, what we argue in the book is that it's important for those who are working in support of the African Union or alongside the African Union to start to understand the African Union in its own context, the uniqueness of African Union operations. Because if you think you are working with the African Union and you think you are working with an operation that is similar to United Nations peacekeeping operations or similar to some other preconceived ideas we have, you are likely to err, to make some mistakes in terms of your assumptions of what you are dealing with. So it's very important to understand these operations in their own right as they are emerging, to understand the variety of these operations, to understand their characteristics. I also have a specific chapter in the book where I argue, in the context of the African Standby Force, that it's important to move from a kind of a standby concept to a concept of just-in-time readiness. And what I mean with that is that when we conceived of the African Standby Force, the model was that we create these regional brigades, and within each of them a rapid deployment capability, which are pre-identified units together with the headquarters. These units are prepared, they are trained, they're at a certain level of readiness. The idea was even that we would, for instance, have one of these regions, ECOWAS for argument's sake, identified as being the region that is on standing readiness for the next 6 months, for instance, and then that would rotate to another region. So to create the standing readiness model. But what we've seen in reality over this experience that I've drawn out to you from Janjaweed to Boko Haram is that in each case, a unique coalition of the willing, if you like, needed to be formed, because each case is unique in terms of the demand that it requires, the kind of forces that it requires, the combination of expertise that it requires. And each situation is unique in terms of which countries are able and willing and interested in participating in that particular operation. And so the standby brigades that we have designed have not in any one of these cases fitted the demand. And in each case, we needed to turn and crystallize at that moment a specific kind of coalition. And I think this is realistic. We can see the same in the larger context. Many of you may be familiar with the Sherbrooke Brigade that we tried to establish for the United Nations. And we also saw that brigade was never deployed. The headquarters was deployed to Ethiopia and Eritrea. The EU have the EU battle groups, similar concept, which has never been deployed, for the same reason that there's a difference between the political project of establishing a standby mechanism, training together, developing the capacity to plan together, and the reality of the moment of deploying, and who is available, who is ready, who is not preoccupied, and so forth. The situation in Burundi is quite an interesting example, because the natural situation there, if the AU were to deploy, were to have deployed in, for instance, January or February this year, the model would have been to turn to the East African Standby Readiness Brigade. But there you had, for instance, Rwanda, who was an immediate neighbor, too close to the problem. You had countries like Uganda and Kenya that were already heavily committed to Somalia. Countries like Tanzania that for political reasons were not willing to deploy. So suddenly you find that your preconceived idea of the regional brigade that would deploy in a situation like that cannot actually do the job in the moment when the pressure is on it to do the job. And you have to look for a different kind of coalition. So if this is our finding, what is the implication? We would argue that the implication is that we need to develop the capacity to put these coalitions of the willing together. We need to invest less in, you know, the ability of the regional mechanisms to put together operations. We need to invest more in the national capacities, because that's the modular capacity that you operate with. And we need to develop more the capacity at the level of the African Union then to put together these coalitions of the willing as they are needed. And the last point I would like to make is relates to the issue of financing, which has been mentioned a couple of times. Funding lies at the crux of what is possible and what is not possible when it comes to African Union operations. We're in this very difficult situation where the African Union has the ambition to play a major role in terms of the conflicts on the African continent. There's an expectation from the international community that the African Union would do that in many cases. But the African Union is dependent on international partners to fund most of its operations, which means that it is not in control at the end of the day in the size of the operation, because that depends on the funding, the duration of the operation, because that depends on the funding in many instances. I mean, we have seen a number of cases, South Africa and Burundi, Nigeria and Liberia and so forth, where when it was really in the strategic interest of one of our countries, they were willing to undertake these operations at their own cost. But that's not the model that we can depend on in terms of developing a kind of a predictable model. So solving the financial aspect is a critical piece of the puzzle that we need to work on over the coming months and years. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can you hear me in the back? I never quite know if my voice will carry. Thanks. All right. Thank you very much, Dorina, and the Africa Center for Strategic Studies for inviting us here today, and for Cedric and Linnea for putting together this panel. We were saying before that so much of what we read these days is in blogs and in short posts and even in articles and reports, and it really takes a book to bring us all together here today, and I will just hold up this book because I don't think anyone else has seen it. Here it is. I'm not involved in the project at all, so I think I can be an impartial advertiser for it. And thank you for inviting me here today to talk about it. the book is really wonderful. It's rich in analysis from scholars and practitioners. I really recommend checking it out. It's worth it. It's worth it to be here today, and it's worth taking a look at the book. What I want to say today is just four things. Talk very briefly about the history of where we've come from. Talk about the nature of the threats, the nature of the response. And then I want to ask you a couple of questions about the book. Okay. So I come to thinking about African solutions to African problems through Herb Howe's work. He was one of my colleagues at Georgetown a number of years ago, and he wrote a seminal article in International Security about ECOMOG in Liberia. And in this article, he said that we would expect that regional forces would be able to do four things that external forces wouldn't be able to do. Regional forces would enjoy, they would understand the conflicts better because they're from the region. They would enjoy greater political acceptance than non-regional forces would. They would be more committed, and they would be able to deploy more quickly and cheaply and have better engaged military equipment and personnel. In sum, he argued that regional forces should have better knowledge, be better accepted, be more committed, and have better military capabilities. And in his analysis of ECOMOG in Liberia, he found exactly the opposite, unfortunately, right? He found that actually none of this panned out for ECOMOG in Liberia. And in the course of ECOMOG's work in Liberia, Nigeria, of course, lost many hundreds of troops. And that experiment, that was the first experiment in creating a sub-regional force to deal as the first responder to regional problems. And I take that as a cautionary tale, and he took it as a cautionary tale for all of us, right? That neighbors can meddle as much as help. And that it's not to say that neighbors will always not be able to help, but that it's important to identify the threat and tailor responses. And I think that's basically what this work is trying to get to, is identifying the threats and tailoring the responses. Okay, so the nature of the threats brings me to the next thing I would want to talk about and to hear from you about. It seems to me that the threats today in Africa are transnational. They're not necessarily unique to the continent, and they're not always warlike in the way I understand war as a scholar, right? I understand civil war usually in terms of the counterinsurgents and secessionist movements, and that is not what characterizes a lot of these conflicts right now. The nature of the threat is different. We have organized crime, and we have terrorists, and they're transnational. So both, and the organized crime is also transnational. In that sense, the nature of the threats, because they're transnational, I don't know if we can limit the response to Africa, which brings me to the next point about responses. We're not actually limiting the response to Africa and African solutions. We have, in each conflict, multiple external actors trying to solve the problem. And just for example, in Somalia, we have two UN operations, I don't know how many from the EU, small things, right? NATO's got a couple, including piracy off the coast. The biggest, of course, goes through the African Union, but what I see is both a fragmentation of the threats. We have more and different and strange actors that I'm not used to seeing, and many of them, right? I think I was recently in Eastern DRC where there are 40 armed groups right now, 40 armed groups, right? We have a fragmentation of the threat and a fragmentation of the response. And that, I think it's hard on both sides to wrap your head around how we come to kind of dealing with fragmentation. So we call, the UN likes to talk about partnerships, and we talked about partnerships now, today. And obviously we need partnerships, but partnerships need to be led by someone. And so far, the coalitions of the willing for the AU have been led by the AU. But I'll end with a couple of questions. In our African model, is the African model one of temporary coalitions of the willing working through the AU? Is that basically what we're talking about now? At the end of the day, they're temporary coalitions. And if that's the case, is it realistic to develop a doctrine for temporary coalitions? Is there some way that we can come to a doctrine of dealing with both transnational terrorist threats and organized crime? And then a couple of other questions. If I look across the continent, there are 6 countries that are most in need right now, right? So we have, starting in Mali, moving across to the Central African Republic, to DRC, the Sudan, Darfur, and South Sudan, and then Somalia. Those are our 6 big areas of conflict and violence. Is there a way to characterize their needs? And if we can come to a characterization, which I've tried to do today, of fragmentation, I don't know if that's an accurate characterization, but maybe you can tell me if you have another way of characterizing the nature of the needs. Can we characterize the needs? Can we characterize what African states that aren't in conflict can do to help? Is there a way to broadly think about what African states can do for those 6 places? And I think Burundi is actually coming together. I don't think Burundi is going to fall into what it has fallen into in the past, but maybe others have a better idea of that. But my final question is this. We're here at NDU, and we're here in Washington. The U.S. has provided, through Okota, we've trained somewhere on the order of 260,000 African troops in the last 12 years. 260,000. You're the one who wrote that report, right? It's a lot. So we have a unique capacity in training. The U.S. has a unique capacity in funding and equipping. And you're here in Washington. What do you think, how can the U.S. help? What were you hoping to gain from this visit to Washington today? Thanks.
Thank you, Lise, and thank you to all of you. I think before I turn it over, maybe I'll have the panel reflect a little bit on the questions that Lise has asked, and then we'll turn it over to all of you. Cedric, I don't know if you would like to start.
I think it's very. Thank you very much for those questions, Lisa. You're kicking us right into the fire. Those are all very, very important questions. As I said, the model is emerging, and we have to see, you know, depending on number of characteristics, how it develops from here on. I would say that when you say temporary coalitions of the willing, I would put that in the context of, you know, where you find your forces from. But what we find in all these operations is that they are anchored in the African Union. So the African Union, whether it is AMISOM or Central African Republic, or to some degree even Boko Haram, is the central fuel point of coordination, political strategic guidance. And then when it comes to the force generation, if you like, we can say that it's a coalition of the willing. It's countries coming together. But at the same time, those countries do cooperate also at the regional mechanism or regional economic communities level, in the African standby force. And so they are not unfamiliar to each other. They remain in a political networks and cooperations and mechanisms and so forth. It's just that they, in a particular mission, come together and cooperate in a specific deployment under the leadership of the African Union. So there is certainly a degree of predictability that comes through that can contribute to, you know, predictable mechanisms for funding, for planning. There's a degree of doctrine that is possible with that arrangement and so forth. So Let me maybe stop with my answer and give the rest to the colleagues to respond to, but that would be my response to the issue of the nature of the coalitions of the willing we're dealing with.
Okay, just to build on what Cedric has already set out, perhaps on the third question then, how can the US help? I think by going back, by supporting temporary coalitions of the willing and thinking that maybe it's more efficient to work through national actors, and maybe it's more efficient to just decide on which response works better for a specific crisis, it's important for partners to the African Union to kind of keep in mind that we still need an institution which links these interventions up to a broader political objective, so which rests on a principled political vision for the continent, because ultimately, we can defeat an enemy. We can stabilize a region. But for that region to see sort of normalized politics, governance structures, and basic services for its inhabitants, for those things to be followed up and to be durable, we need, I think, the African Union and sub-regional actors to kind of build on from specific missions. So, in a way, there is a tension there that you've pinpointed very sharply, that we see a model developing which has fragmentation, the risk of fragmentation as part of it. But we are at the same time, we're also learning to work as part of a more complex hybrid environment of intervening actors. And so let's hope that we are able to learn quickly enough that complementary roles can be optimized.
Thank you. Thank you for those very, very good questions. I think from my side, in terms of model, I don't think it would be useful for us to characterize or to try and label what we do in ways that aspires to universal validity. I think context would always shape the kinds of operations that we deploy. And if you look at the practices that we have had and continue to have on the continent, at least from the side of the AU, three broad categories can be discerned. The first is you have situations where the African Union mandates an operation and deploy or generate forces for deployment. And I think AMISOM is a good example. But increasingly, we are also having missions where we have very limited coordination responsibilities, where we simply authorize those operations or we support those operations. And the case of the multinational joint task force against Boko Haram would be a classical example of AU authorized operations that have been, of course, closely commanded by both Nigeria and other affected states of northeastern region of northeastern part of Nigeria and neighboring countries, and from that standpoint or against that backdrop, what you then need to design, of course, I think there's a need for a doctrine. But what we've had in the last 10 years is that the African standby force was developed with the mindset of the 1990s, and we did not take into consideration what you described as fragmented security threats. And that is why a decision was taken by AU member states in January 2016 for us to be able to align the scenarios that we have developed through the African standby force with new threats or contemporary security challenges that we face as the continent. So I think it would be useful for us to frame future responses against the threats that we face. In terms of the characterizing the needs, I think what we see today is a manifestation of the politics of security, and I use that word quite loosely, where you have a number of actors, including regional and extra-regional actors responding to a crisis in ways that are not properly coordinated. So the example you gave, Lisa, about Somalia is actually a manifestation of this, you know, a politics of security, because a number of actors are simply trying to achieve or supposedly trying to achieve peace in Somalia without necessarily coordinating. And this is where we need to address future interventions. How can the U.S. help? I think one of the issues that we need to recognize is that behavioral standards must be universal. So issues to do with adherence to human rights standards cannot be compromised. And this is the recognition that we've had as the African Union, that if we have to deal with issues of conduct and discipline, or specifically of sexual exploitation and abuse, we continue to maintain a zero tolerance approach on that. However, when it comes to functional standards or standards relating to operational capacities, it has to be tied to the functionality of our capabilities. And in this instance, I would give you an example. You may not have what you'd categorize as a battalion, amongst the Chadian contingent. And this is what was clearly manifested when the Chadian forces went into or were responding to the threats in northern Mali. There were about 650 personnel that were made up of one battalion, and I think in the military it's 750, if I'm correct. But they got the job done. So what we need to focus on, therefore, is not about trying to develop universal standards for operational capacities. Rather, we should consider ways in which we can support some of the TCCs or African TCCs to simply do the job better in all of these crisis situations. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have two microphones on either side. And what I'll do is I'll take maybe three at a time and then turn it back to the panel. So the floor is open.
I'm Colonel Abubakar Adamu. I'm a Nigerian Army officer, a student here in the National Defense University. I'm in Eisenhower School. First, I want to make a comment, then ask you a question. My comment is that I have participated in Darfur. I was one of the first people deployed in Mali. I've participated in ECOMOC for like 6 years in Liberia. And I think I've been privileged to know how the Chad Basin Commission, before I came here, the MNGTF was formed up. First, I think I've not read your book, but I think you have the impression as if the MNJTF is AU-driven. I don't think it's AU-driven. It's Chad Basin Commission-driven. So it's not AU-driven. That is the mission, the one between Nigeria, Chad, and Cameroon, and Benin Republic joining joining the mission. I think it's not AU-driven. I think it's Chad Basin-driven. Also, I think there's an issue of funding, generally with the AU missions. I'm very much aware that in Darfur and the initial deployment in Mali, there were a lot of challenges with funding of the missions by AU. Meanwhile, when we were in ECOMOG, when it was purely a Nigerian mission or funding, we had little or no problem with the funding. And that's why today I'm sure you see that one of the striving democracies is Liberia and Sierra Leone, which is a credit to the ECOMOG mission there. Now, my question is, how are you in your book? I don't know whether you've participated with the, or you have, before writing your book, I don't know how you've interacted with the participants or the countries in the African sub-region before writing your book. Because you spoke so much about peace support operation. To my knowledge, I think all the missions that we've undertaken are not peace support. They are mostly peace enforcement missions. So I don't know how to reconcile between peace support or peace enforcement. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Gentleman right here.
my name is Ernest. I'm a doctoral student at George Mercer University. I just want to add to what Colonel Abubakar said. I've been researching in Northeast Nigeria. And again, I was a kind of, I would say that the AU Well, I don't want to belittle to AU, but in terms of peace support operation, Nigeria have played a very great role in the continent. There is no peace operation that Nigeria did not play a part in the continent. But looking at Northeast Nigeria, I was wondering what is happening. Because right now, even as I'm talking, moving forward, most of the villagers being liberated by Boko Haram, the IDPs cannot go back because they are afraid of what will happen to them. So I just want to know, moving forward, what is AU doing to make sure that the IDPs go back to their communities? Because even at a certain point in time, the head of the operation said that maybe some of the civilian joint task force will be now deployed to go to those communities. So I want to know, what is the AU doing to make sure that peace return in Northeast Nigeria?
Okay, and then there's one question right here in the front.
My name is Peter Struck. I'm a president of an NGO that operates in the Sahel and part of the Sahara since, I've been working there since 1980. And I attended the forum, the second annual forum for peace and security in Dakar, 8 and 9 and 10 November. The thrust there was by African leaders, several heads of state and many foreign ministers or other appropriate people were there. I listened to the presentation today, and it kind of clashes with some of the presentations by the African leaders that were at this forum. It was attended by about 700 people from all over the of the world, but mostly out of Europe and Africa. A couple of points, though. You were talking about the most serious parts, areas of problems, and somewhere Libya has to be right on top, and they were already talking about it then. Secondly, in terms of responding to the funding issue was always there. But I wanted to say something about Ethiopia because they unilaterally went north to confront the problem in northern Mali, recognizing that if they didn't defeat that problem, they were at great risk as a nation. And then later the French came. But all the Western press say this was the French Serval program that was in the lead. So this some disconnects between what I heard in Dakar by the heads of state or their foreign ministers, and what I'm hearing out of the Western press, not necessarily what I'm hearing from you. There's this conflict. Thank you.
I think I'm going to leave most of the Nigerian questions for Jide, seeing that he's Nigerian, and he would know better how to skirt the sensitivities. But I can take the easy one and say that in the AU peace support operations doctrine, which I think is similar to the NATO and EU peace support operation doctrine, that's not peacekeeping. That is, includes a spectrum that includes peace enforcement. So peace support operations is the broader doctrine that encompasses a range of actions, including peace enforcement. So the AU doctrine is peace support operations, but within the AU doctrine, we can do a range of things, whether it's an observer mission in Burundi or whether it's an enforcement action in Somalia against insurgents. So that's the doctrinal. And maybe one other thing to mention, partly in the context of what you said about the AU role in for instance, the Boko Haram operation, but perhaps a bit more broader, also responding to the question that Lisa raised about fragmentation. What I do see in many African contexts is that there's a very concerted effort to create a political agreement on how to respond to a particular action. So you would see, for instance, that the troop contributing countries involved in Somalia, you would have the heads of state of those countries meet, and or foreign ministers and or chiefs of defense. The same would be, for instance, in the case of the Great Lakes. Before we had the Force Intervention Brigade deployed as part of MONUSCO, you really had the heads of the leaders of the Great Lakes region and other key countries come together and find a consensus over time about how to deal with that situation, and then a consensus for force to be used in that particular case. So although the situations may be very fragmented, there's also at the same time political commitment at the highest level in many of these cases for a particular concerted form of action. And then it's easier to take that action when you have that kind of political will generated around a situation like that. And that means, you mentioned earlier that regional organizations, one of the aspects is you expect that they're more committed. And you said that that was not the case in ECOMOG. But I think that is precisely the case in, for instance, situations like the operations against Boko Haram or the operations against Somalia. You see that countries that have a national interest in defeating an insurgency, dealing with the situation, have a great level of commitment, much more so than, let's say, countries that contribute troops to an European Union or United Nations operation. So I do think that is an important characteristic of these kind of operations.
Just a brief comment. You asked how did we deal with these subsidiarity tensions in the books, the tensions that sometimes are created between sub-regional actors or lead states or the African Union peace and security architecture overall. And so we do have a chapter dealing with these political tensions on subsidiarity. And also maybe just to say, if using the term African peace and security architecture, that to me means that one thinks about the pillars that make up that peace and security architecture. And those are, of course, the foundational structures are the sub-regional actors. So there's no conflict there between saying that it's more AU-led or more regional-led necessarily. But thank you for the comment.
Yeah, very briefly, I think, on Boko Haram, if you recall, on the 29th January 2015, that was last year, the heads of state of the African Union authorized the PSC the deployment of the MNJTF. And that's why I described the MNJTF as an authorized operation. Of course, in terms of the actual operation on the ground, you still have the LCBC states and Benin playing a lead role, notwithstanding through the support that we have received from the EU. The African Union has deployed a mission support team to N'Djamena, providing support, assistance, of course, supporting the mission in the area of the establishment of the force headquarters, but also providing other additional capacities. We are currently, as I speak, some of my colleagues are actually in N'Djamena now doing the review of that particular support provided to the MNJTF. So on one hand, you're correct to say that this mission is being led by the LCBC states, but it has received its political legitimacy from the African Union through the authorization that was made in 2015. I don't know if I heard you correctly, but the issue you raised regarding the deployment of Ethiopian forces, okay, Chadian forces, because I know, because Ethiopia, I thought, yes, you're very correct. In terms of the actual offensive operations and in terms of the stability that was gained in northern Mali, it was simply, and I think I did reiterate that point, where the Chadian forces on the ground, they lost quite a lot of lives. In terms of the timing of that deployment, it seems to me that Operation Serval came in a few days, but they were not necessarily conducting ground offensive. In terms of ground offensive, the Chadian troops were actually on the ground. Before the, in fact, I don't think the French forces ever deployed any ground combat troops, but I stand to be corrected here. So to a large extent, you're very correct that sometimes the mixed messages we get from the press may not necessarily represent what we see on the ground. But yes, I think I'll stop there. Those were the two main questions that were asked.
Thank you very much. My name is Jim Shear. I'm a global fellow at the Woodrow Wilson Center. And very much appreciate your very enlightening remarks, all panelists. Question, how do AU peace support operations broadly intersect with the justice and accountability mission. I ask that because in other venues, there have been quite a different range of reactions. In Bosnia, post-Srebrenica, the IFOR, the NATO force, ran away from the mission in terms of forensics, in terms of atrocity site documentation. On the other hand, in East Timor, the Australian-led Interfet operation actually went to the sites and helped to secure them and open the door for atrocity assessment. I raise the issue because it is a delicate one in Africa, as we all know, and there are practical and other issues about balancing peace and justice issues. On the other hand, I would say there are some Muslims in Bangui who are only alive today because of the ICC, that Sister Josephine waved off anti-Balaka militias as they were coming into a monastery with desperate Muslim families huddling there, and she said, "This site is under the jurisdiction of the ICC, and if you go in, you will be taken to The Hague." And they left. So it's an interesting issue. It's here to stay. So I'm just wondering how the AU wrestles with the justice and accountability issue. Thank you.
Then Nima in the front.
My name is Clarissa Shagun, and I'm an independent consultant, but very interested in the peace of Africa and conflict resolution. Thank you for your research. I think you point out quite a few interesting aspects that could be incorporated in conflict resolution. But my point is, who are the stakeholders, this book, who is the target group, and how do you intend to use it as an advocacy tool? Because it's good to do all the research, but how does it affect the situation in Africa? How are you going to use it positively? Thank you.
Richard Loban from the Naval War College, where I teach African security and transnational threats. And I'd like to return to the comment raised about Libya. I haven't read your book, but I detected maybe it's not there. And it seems to me that of all the conflicts, the six that were noted, they do have either a counteroffensive or some geographical parameters to them, and that's maybe a bit encouraging. But for Libya, I think we have, my question to the panel is, what can be done to stop the hemorrhage of small arms and light weapons and to somehow move from one government to two governments, and now we have three governments in Libya? And what can the African Union do in, I think, maybe the gravest of all security cases for the continent of Africa? Thank you.
Okay, these are excellent questions. I think I'll start with the easier one, perhaps, which is how to use this book to improve practices. One of the ways we've been doing that is that we've had regular seminars with practitioners and policymakers within sub-regional organizations and the African Union. So we've been, in 2011, we had one in Uppsala, in 2013 in Cape Town, and we'll now have some brainstorming on what to do next. And so the idea is to discuss directly with people who are shaping these policies and to exchange ideas on where to go next. And how do African peace operations intersect with justice and accountability? I mean, this is not one of the core aims of the book, to look into this question, but it's one of the questions that in my own research really drives me. Accountability mechanisms and oversight mechanisms, that is something that I think is absolutely crucial that they will have to develop at the African peace and security architecture level, because unless there is this continued discussion about accountability, I think that the African Union would run into the same situation as, you know, Cedric was saying that one of the justifications for African interventions is that you go and support your neighbor. But when accountability problems get to a certain level, legitimacy for the AU will be lost in the long term, and then it'll put itself in a situation where it's open to the same accusations that external actors were open to previously. So as a long-term issue, I think you're right, that is absolutely crucial. I mean, there are, and Gide and another author in the book, Yvonne Akpasom, has written more extensively about how what is being done at the policy level in peace operations today to kind of get to these issues. But yeah, point very well taken.
Yes, I think on justice, I think the point that needs to be made very strongly is that I think from the practice of peace processes that have been, you know, significantly influenced by the African Union, justice is always and will continue to be an important aspect of the broader peace processes that we undertake across you know, countries emerging from conflict. I think that is a priority. The most important point, however, is the timing that we have to, or when should we seek justice as part of this peace process. I think that is where we've always had certain contestations with non-African partners. Our interpretation of when that would be has always been, you know, a difference or a dissonance with how most partners continue to perceive when justice should be sought. But notwithstanding, I think there is a general agreement between, you know, African stakeholders as well as non-African stakeholders that at some point in the peace process, there is a need for us to promote or pursue justice. And in light of that, I think there have been a number of steps that we have taken, both in the case of or through the AUHIP, the high-level panel on Sudan, also, in fact, in the case of Mali and Central African Republic. In terms of the missions themselves, what are we doing? I think, like I mentioned earlier, it is so difficult for us to, I think it's important that pre-deployment training, pre-deployment verifications, all take into account some of these issues of accountability such that we can minimize casualties or civilian casualties in mission. And I think that is where we are getting even the support of the U.S. Through our quota programs in the design of curriculum that reflects some of these issues of international law, including humanitarian law. There are mechanisms also, in the case of AMISOM, for the first time, we have now established what we've called the civilian casualties tracking response and analysis and response cell, CCTAC, to look into some of the issues that you've talked about. So I think it is a work in progress. And if you look at the statistics, in Somalia today you have 22,126 uniformed personnel. Allegations of sexual exploitation and abuse by these forces have been less than. Of course, it is not, we are not supposed to condone, you know, any form of exploitation, but we've only had allegations of about six. The question is, can we all together eliminate that in very difficult circumstances? Maybe not. But more importantly, what do we do when you have these allegations? I think that's the more important point. And as you can see from the way we responded to these allegations, there were a number of measures that we put in place, including you know, rotating the troops, you know, back to their political capitals and hoping that they would be. And for the first time, the Ugandan forces actually constituted a martial court in Somalia. Of course, there are cost implications to that, but those are some of the measures that we have taken as the African Union to prevent and effectively respond to that. Yeah, and it would continue to improve, in my view, as we learn, the entire governance systems of peace support operations. In terms of advocacy, I think my colleague has already mentioned that AU's response in Libya, the UN is taking the lead on Libya. Don't ask me why, but of course there is a historical background to that. But as you know, we appointed the former president of Tanzania to support the political process, and he would continue to support. Today we have a very limited role. It is very unlikely, from my own personal view, that the AU would deploy, a hard security component, to Libya. But in terms of how we support the political process, I think that would be one of the primary forms of our intervention in Libya. Thank you.
I wanted to address a couple of things, and starting with the disconnect between the Western press versus what's going on the ground sometimes, and just to give one illustration, touching on this problem of sexual abuse and exploitation and justice and accountability. So, and the transition between AU troops and UN. So I was recently conducting field work in the Central African Republic, and I was able to spend a couple of days with the battalion from Congo Brazzaville. So these are guys who served under the AU and bravely and helped to stabilize Centrafrique, and then who rehadded to become UN peacekeepers. And in that rehadding, there was some retraining, but the hardest part of the new peacekeeping mandate was that they now, unlike when they were serving under the AU, with the UN, they had the power of arrest, which they didn't have as part of MISCA. So in this UN operation, which is unique in some ways, they were able, in their interactions with rebels, who are often just gangs, really, rather than trying to figure out how to defeat them militarily, they were able to take an entirely different approach, which was to arrest them and disarm them and bring them to justice, which is really working quite effectively. Anyway, this is a way of saying that, from my experience in the Central African Republic, this innovation with policing and justice, the main military, the main battalions in Bangui right now, from Rwanda and Burundi, are under police command. And so they call this in the UN the policization of the military. And this is an innovation in peacekeeping. Most of these guys were serving under the AU, so they have experience, they have commitment, they know the terrain, they know the people, they can actually speak the language, which I think is a completely different picture from what you see in the Western press today coming out of the Central African Republic, which mainly has to do with sexual abuse and exploitation. And I would just say that the idea of dealing with troops small in number who are committing abuses and to send home the entire battalion, it, frankly, to me, it doesn't make sense. I don't understand why we're talking now about sending home all troops from Brazzaville, all troops from Kinshasa, everyone from Morocco, when those troops have been serving in Centrafrique really, the vast majority of them have been serving really quite well. And I don't know why we're switching this principle of individual accountability, which the UN absolutely has to develop better mechanisms to deal individually with people who commit crimes. That is a fact. But to send home the entire battalion, I don't understand what that serves. And I think the UN could probably learn from the AU in its response and figuring out how to deal with court martials.
Lawrence Freeman. I've been doing research for economic development in Africa for 25 years, and I also work on the International Committee of the Lake Chad Basin Commission. In the situation with Boko Haram, I really don't understand, you probably all do better than I do, that there is a tremendous lack of coordination. The AU has authorized this multi-government task force, but it's being conducted to a large part out of N'Djamena with the Lake Chad Commission. But it's being driven by President Buhari, from what I've been told by my contacts in Nigeria. Most of the $700 million that was pledged by the international community has not arrived. Most of the money is coming from Nigeria. So that's going to be a maximum $100 million if they've met the full requirement. So that's not a serious effort. The response from the U.S. has only come of late in terms of actionable intelligence. And then the question is, how do you hold these cities? The Nigerian economy is too weak. They can't hold the cities once they drive Boko Haram out. And then you're also dealing with 2.5 million internally displaced people. So unless there's a massive change in the international community and from the rest of Africa, this problem, I don't see it being solved on the ground or afterwards in terms of taking positions unless there's a much bigger level of support. And then that raises a larger question, which I don't know if your book goes into, which is how do you prevent these crises? And it's clear in the case of Nigeria and Northeast area that without economic development, you're never going to end these crises. I've been working to develop a refurbishing of Lake Chad, which would change the whole complexion of the Lake Chad Basin where Boko Haram recruits. And if you go to Mali, I'm sure you all have, you realize that two-thirds of the country is a desert, which is ideal recruiting ground. So there's been really a lack of an economic component to all our counterterrorism efforts. And I don't know if you addressed that in your book or not, but peace and security cannot be discussed outside of that context. But also, I have my more specific question on Nigeria and Boko Haram. Thank you.
This gentleman right here.
Thank you. My name is Franklin Moore. I'm currently working with Africare. And my question, I want to go back to the coalition of the willing to ask a question. And that is, to the degree that you, as you did your research, to what degree did you look at operations which the participants in the operation come from the sub-region where the conflict exists versus that coalition of the willing drawing in states from beyond the region where the conflict exists, and whether as you look at that, that creates a communication type or relationship between a sub-regional organization where the conflict exists and the AU, so that in some cases it may be the sub-regional organization that is taking first movement and they're being validated by the AU, or the AU is taking first movement and being validated by the sub-regional organization.
I just want to say thank you very much for all the panel members and your grateful insight so far today. My expertise is in Iraq and Afghanistan, and then previously in Mali, specifically working with those 260,000 soldiers, as you mentioned, getting trained. And the issue that I saw time and time again was the question is, why is there a prioritization of funding and increasing the funding when going through Nigeria, go through Liberia, go through Mali, all these countries, time and time again, majority of that money is being siphoned off by the government for corrupt means. Specifically, when I was in Mali, I spoke with a lot of the NISMA forces. I spoke with UNHCR, various forces, and this is a very unscientific number, but majority of them are saying that 80% of their funds through ways was being siphoned off. As we know, prior to the collapse in 2012, there was major reports in the army, Malian army, of ghost soldiers. Even a lot of those funds were finding their way, actually, funds and military arms they were giving the Malian army were finding their ways being sold on the black market, and the highest buyers most likely is Islamist groups. So with that, what do you see? Why is there not a prioritization of increased governance of the countries that we are supporting? And so if so, what do you see AU's role as arguing for increased governance? Thank you.
I think, again, back to the issue of the MNJTF, I think the initial concept of operations, the CONOPS, which established the MNJTF, was precisely at the, I think when you look back retrospectively at the CONOPS, it was to prioritize degrading Boko Haram. So there was from the outset emphasis on the security track. Less attention at the time was paid to stabilization act programs and initiatives, like you've mentioned. I think as the, based on the reports we are receiving from the ground, there is a gradual realization that we now have to balance the offensive operations, especially in light of the progress that we are beginning to see on the ground, especially in northeastern part of Nigeria, with stabilization programs. And I think this is, you know, where we're beginning to reallocate or reprioritize the support that we are getting from both the Nigerian government. They have disbursed $21 million, which is going towards the operations, but we are considering that additional disbursement could go towards some of these community-based programming that you have identified as a priority. So I think the initial focus, which was quite understandable, that in light of the successes or relative successes of Boko Haram at the time, there was a need for us to do one thing and one thing alone, and significantly degrade Boko Haram. But now, we've just had the renewal of the mandate of MNJTF, and one of the tasks of the assessment team and that has just been deployed there is to actually identify some of the new priority areas, including some of what you've mentioned. In terms of increased governance, I still work for the African Union. I don't see, I wouldn't be able to make any comments on that today, but I think you're probably referring to troop allowances. I think that's what you're referring to. That, yes, indeed, because we pay these TCCs, troop allowances, we pay their government troop allowances, they may not necessarily be giving the entire amount to all the uniformed personnel that have been deployed or the troops that have been deployed on the ground. And which is, it's against that background that, you know, the EU has reduced troop allowance, I mean, their support to troop allowances by 20% in AMISOM. But it's a general point that we have consistently made. It is a sovereignty issue. You cannot determine or speak on behalf of respective states on how much they should pay their troops or not, or how much they shouldn't pay their troops. So I think that is beyond my pay grade right now. I wouldn't want to speak on that. On the last point, on the comparison between the regional TCCs and non-regional TCCs, I'm trying to think about an example, but none is coming to mind at the moment. But what you find is that according to the protocol establishing the Peace and Security Council, we see the regions as the center of gravity in terms of the generation of capabilities, and in which case the African standby force doctrine is framed around that, which is that we have to generate our capabilities. However, in light of the threats we faced in Mali, and the threat that that Algeria and ECOWAS member states were faced with, there is a need for us to now adapt the African peace and security architecture. And that is why we've commenced a process, the Nuakchot process, which is basically to do just that, the operationalization of the African Peace and Security Council architecture in the Sahel-Saharan region is precisely to bring states that are not necessarily part of, ECOWAS to deal with a common threat, or the threats that Lisa mentioned in terms of the fragmented nature of our threats. I think so. We are consistently adapting the APSA to address some of the contemporary challenges that we are facing. Thank you.
Maybe just to echo it, I mean, I think absolutely the importance of the economic component is we can fully endorse that. But also the dilemma, I think, probably there's many people in the room who have been working on insurgency doctrines and so on. And I think we all face this dilemma that we are sometimes able to, through military means, stabilize the situation. But it really only makes sense if we do that, if there is then work on the political and economic side to use that opportunity that is created through the security dimension to move forward. And we see in Somalia and Mali and elsewhere that often that is lacking, because the situations are politically very weak, economically very weak. There's not enough funding internationally or otherwise to actually make those investments. And that part of the problem is something that takes a very long time to deal with. And many of these insurgency situations that we face in the Sahel and Mali, and in the case of the Boko Haram, you have these center-periphery tensions where the peripheries are where these insurgents come from, and they have faced years and generations of neglect. And to fix that in a short period of time is extremely difficult. So it's a dilemma for our stabilization and insurgency doctrines, because in a sense it's inherently flawed if we can't, if we stabilize but we don't have the means to deal with the political and economic situations. On the issue of sub-regional or regional organizations and the AU and interested and non-interested parties, that's actually, I think, one of the interesting differences between African Union operations and let's say the UN peacekeeping doctrine, which really holds in the United Nations context that in order to ensure impartiality and neutrality, you want troop-contributing countries that do not have an interest in the conflict, that can be impartial, that are seen as impartial. Whereas when it comes to the peace enforcement type of stabilization operations that we need to undertake in, whether it's in northern Mali or whether it is in Somalia, we actually, the only people who are really willing to use the level of force, to invest the level of political commitment necessary, would be states that have an interest at stake. And so we're dealing with a completely different set of dynamics. And of course, in this, these kind of forces from interested states that have a political commitment to the situation is necessary on the one hand, because nobody else is going to be willing to spill the blood to deal with that situation. At the same time, they do cause problems because they're interested. They're seen very often by the host nation as having particular interests at stake. And so one have to use them on the other hand. On the other hand, you have to manage those dimensions. And we also see with the, as Jiri said, the design of the African peace and security architecture is with these regional centers of gravity. But in so many of the situations we faced, so Mali is a good example, lying on the periphery of ECOWAS. Central African Republic is a good example, lying on the periphery of ECAS region, that these conflicts fall on the border of the region. And if you approach them from one specific regional economic community perspective, you lose out other countries that may have a particular interest and role to potentially play. So that speaks to my earlier point of the importance of flexibility and nimbleness, and not to fix ourselves too much in particular structures when we seek for solutions for dealing with these problems, but to try to remain as pragmatic as possible. And that's why we use this word coalition of the willings in a positive sense. In other words, which are the countries that really have a stake? Which are the countries that can make a contribution in this particular moment? How can we work with them is what we mean with that phrase.
Okay, we'll just take maybe a last round, a couple. Yes, sir. Over here. And then...
Good Good afternoon. My name is Colonel Philippe de Montenon. I'm with the Embassy of France here in Washington. Just a quick comment, sir. Going back to the operations in Mali, and maybe to correct one thing you mentioned, you were questioning whether the France had launched the operation Serval on the ground. Well, yes, it did, and it did even before the Chadians launched their own operation in the north. That doesn't take away anything from what the Chadians did, and actually we were extremely happy with their performance in this operation. We think that they have set the standards for the type of operations that an African contingent can conduct in such a constrained time frame. But French soldiers had started to give their life on the ground before the Chadians intervened, and I think it's right to correct that. Maybe a quick comment about this operation. If we look back at several operations and the operations of this Chadian contingent 3 years ago, it definitely looked like a great success, and we were able to push back the jihadists in the north and bring back Malian forces in the north. Where if we look at northern Mali today, it doesn't look as successful, and the situation is definitely not as good as we would like it to be. As a soldier, I would like to share this idea that it brings us back to the fact that military success can only be success in the long term if it's tied to a well-defined political strategy and well-defined political goals. And I think that those goals should be actually defined even under time constraint at any time we launch a military operation.
Hi, I'm Nick Hanlon from the Center for Security Policy. I'd like to thank you all for your thoughtful discussion. On the topic of future stability in the Kivus, I just want to invite you to discuss what factors will affect security there, particularly in Uvira, Bukavu, and Goma. It doesn't seem like, at least from the way I understand it, there are many in the region who are interested in the sort of future stability of what would be a coalition of the willing. Thoughts on that?
The lady in red over there. Yes, you.
Hello, my name is Madeline. I'm with the Stimson Center here in DC. Thank you very much for everyone for coming and chatting with us today. I have two questions. One is specifically for Mr. De Koenig about you mentioned the importance of building the capacity of the AU to build these coalitions of the willing. And I wondered if you could just speak a bit more about what that would look like, what that kind of capacity is, and how you would build it. And then my second question more generally is just about the role you see private sector playing in peace in Africa in general. I'm thinking specifically of some cross or transnational tech companies that are really growing. That also have a vested interest in peace. Do you see there being a role for the private sector more generally? And if so, would there be any partnership with the AU, or would that kind of contradict the idea of the union? Thank you.
Thank you, Robin. Maybe I'll take Madeleine's question and leave the rest for colleagues. So when I talk about focusing on the capacity to deal then with this more flexible situation of putting coalitions of the willing together, first of all, what I'm referring to is a mindset which is not linked to kind of template planning, right, and not fixed too much in one specific model. A mindset which means that, you know, we approach each situation with a more of an openness of trying to identify who the countries are that in that particular situation would be the best partners for the African Union. This would both be in terms of troop contributing countries, but also there's a larger situation at stake in terms of who can help to build the political coalition, which international partners may have a particular interest in that country. What is the United Nations, others thinking about that? So that's one part of it. The other part of it is, of course, that the more we know beforehand about, you know, in general, who is willing to commit to contribute certain capacities to the African Union, that makes that planning much better. So that is the general value of the African standby force and of that kind of pledging, so that you know who to call if you need particular type of equipment. You know at least who's willing to potentially give those. They may not be willing to give them in this particular situation, but at least you've got five people to call instead of 53 to find out who may be giving that information, right? So there's a lot of pre-work that you can do, even when it comes to coalitions of the willing, to understand what kind of capacities may potentially be available. But really it's about planning in a more nimble mindset as opposed to planning templates in a very templated basis is what my core point there. In terms of the private sector, of course, very important. Various initiatives are underway, have been underway to reach out to the private sector. You may know, for instance, that when it came to the Ebola mission that the African Union deployed in West Africa, there was a pledging conference including with the private sector, and the private sector actually contributed quite a bit to that particular operation. And that kind of situation is, again, probably much more likely to lead to private sector contributions than a military intervention. But at the same time, it is the private sector. And so the relationship has to be very an open and possibilities of looking for investment. The private sector is not a charitable foundation. They're firstly going to look at in profit and investment possibilities. And then in that context, they will look at social responsibility and so forth. So I don't think, again, there's one way that we can recommend, but certainly a continued engagement, a discussion, reaching out, creating opportunities for discussion is what we need to look for private sector engagement.
Yes, I think, yeah, we are not in any way discounting the role of France in creating stabilization, initial stabilization in Mali. I think if you read the literature on the response to the crisis in Mali, what you would hardly find in the literature today is the role of AFISMA, including Chad. I think that was the point that we were trying to make quite strongly. And what we are saying is that, inasmuch, I mean, the deployment timeline was, they were just a few days apart, if you recall. I think the French forces went in, I think the 9th of January or thereabout, and of course, a week later, you had elements of ECOWAS standby force deploying to Bamako, and eventually you had also Chad deploying as well. So I think in ensuring that we complete the story in terms of the role of various actors in Mali, there is a need for us to also underscore the role of the African Union forces through AFISMA, and of course Chad, that was not part of ECOWAS, the role they played. And just to also make the point that you're very right, there is a need for us to have, an alignment between, the offensive operations and the political process. And I think this is a point that we've always emphasized in terms of, including if you look at, say, for instance, the two benchmarking exercises that we did jointly with the United Nations on Somalia, and also the benchmarking exercise that we did in Mali as well. And today we see a reversal in some of the security gains that have been made in Mali. In fact, a team led by a colleague of mine have been deployed to Bamako to consider options for the deployment of a rapid intervention force, which of course will be composed of largely contingents from the AU member states. This is just a recognition of some of the limitations of associated with the UN peacekeeping mission, MINUSMA, currently in Mali, because of their limitations, particularly in conducting offensive operations in the northern part of Mali. So, yes, I share your views. I don't know much about the intervention by the French forces there. That's why I couldn't make any determination as to whether you conducted ground offensive operations or not. On Kivu, I really cannot make any intervention there, apart from the reports we get from MONUSCO. And of course, as you know, we have the Force Intervention Brigade as part of MONUSCO. I do not know, have much information about the political context in that country. And then finally, on the role of the private sector, as Cedric mentioned, we've seen a potential for, you know, private sector-led resource mobilization in, to the African Union through the response that we had of in support of ASEOWA, which was the response to the Ebola-affected countries in West Africa. And so we can actually reproduce that model as a way of galvanizing support from the private sector as well in relation to peace and security. But of course, there needs to be that cost-benefit analysis between ourselves and this private sector that we are trying to attract. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you all for your questions, and thank you to our panelists for their very rich responses. Okay, great. We hope to see you back.